Hey everybody, welcome back. Another edition of Tuesday's Tech Talk. Before we get started today, I would like to draw everyone's attention to this little gem right here. This is something one of my customers made for me. He got a new CNC machine and thought he'd try it out by knocking me out a new GR Research logo on a plaque. Thank you, Peter. I love it. I'm going to set that on my desk and enjoy that for a long time. Thank you very much. Now, this week's episode, we're going to kind of build on and pick up from where we left off. Last week, we've been talking about measurements. We looked at what I call the measurements that matter. They're the measurements that I feel tell you the most about how a speaker is going to actually sound. We looked at frequency response, on-axis response. We looked at horizontal off-axis. We looked at the vertical off-axis. We looked at the impedance curve. And we looked at spectral decay. And we looked at examples of all that stuff. And had some people questioning my thoughts on spectral decay. I said that was the one measurement that I felt would tell you the most about how a speaker actually sounds. I stick by that. I know some guys say, hey, you can see what's in the spectral decay just in the frequency response. No, you can't see the decay rate over time in a frequency response. However, you can see the frequency response in the spectral decay. It's the top line. So spectral decay, again, it's going to point out any kind of problem, ringing, breakup, stored energy issues, reflections within the box, a lot of different things. It's going to show up in the spectral decay. But even if it's clean, it will also show you how fast the speaker really is. And the speed really tells you a lot about a speaker. If something's playing and stopping immediately, you know, the level of resolution detail are going to be much, much cleaner, much faster than something that takes longer to settle. I mean, I stick with that. Spectral decay tells you an awful lot about how a speaker's going to sound. You guys just need to learn how to read and understand it. It's not that difficult. Again, though, it's just a tool. It's a tool we use in the design aspect. It's a tool that we use in the evaluation stages of a speaker. It's just a tool. It won't tell you exactly how a speaker is going to sound. For that, we move to what I feel like is an even more important tool in the arsenal of doing the design work. So we're going to go take a look at what that tool really is. And it is not here in the measurement area. It is in another location. Let's go have a look. And here we are, the listening room, the one tool that is invaluable, the one tool that is above and beyond importance. This is where the rubber meets the road. I can't overstate the importance more of the listening room. And not just having a listening room, but having an elite level listening room. Having a listening room that'll allow you to hear all those intangibles. Having a room that's going to allow you to get those speakers well out into the room, away from the walls. Something that's going to allow you to hear the differences that you're not going to see in the measured responses. The differences in soundstage layering, the difference in the spatial cues, the difference in where things are within the sound field. Those are things and comparisons that need to be made here in order to take a product to the next level. The measurements, like I said, are a tool. They're going to tell you various aspects of the speaker. You're going to see if there's problems or if there's not problems. But it won't tell you, none of those measurements are going to tell you exactly how a speaker sounds. I guarantee I can make two speakers that measure identically, but sound very different depending on the quality of the parts, quality of everything that goes into the speaker. And unless you have a well-treated, well-designed listening room with a top-level system, you're just not going to hear it. And this room is just a empty room that was in my house. It was a room that we weren't using yet. We bought this house a couple years ago. We remodeled that end of the house. We remodeled that end of the house. This is the big center room that we just haven't done anything with yet. At some point, I think we may give it a nice, warm, earthy feel. I'm gonna bring in a bunch of reclaimed barn wood and give it a nice, warm feeling and put a great big pool table right here in the middle of the room. And this will be my room. But for right now, I don't have a huge listening room at the shop yet, which is being built. And so this is making do for a listening room. So even a makeshift room can work out really well. I just brought in room treatments from the things that we take with us to a show. It's a curtain system. There are curtains that go around the room. There are thick foam wedges in the corners that are used for tube traps. There's a diffuser in the center behind the curtain. There are diffusers in the corners. There are diffusers on the walls to the sides. The whole room is treated pretty well. There's carpet on the floor, or big rugs on the floor. If it were a permanent room, I probably would have treated the ceiling and everything, but for right now, it works really well. It's about 28 feet long from one end to the other and about 17 feet wide. The ceilings are 12 feet tall, so it's big enough to let me do what I need to do. As you can see, the speakers are well out into the room. This is just a speaker that I've been developing and working on, something kind of new. I've thrown it out there as a kit. Some of my customers have built some already. As soon as I can get my hands on an endless supply of these planar magnetic neotens, I'm going to relaunch it again as a product. But yeah, the room. Can't stress enough the importance of the room. There are things that I can switch in and out that are going to make notable differences within the sound field. And if you just had a pair of speakers sitting in an untreated room, a foot off the wall, you'll never hear those differences. If you're listening to a single speaker, and I know some designers will just play the amplifier they're working on a single speaker, you really can't get any feel for soundstage and things like that working in mono. I mean, you have to have something really set up that allow you to hear all those differences. So what I'm going to do next is I'm going to give you a walkthrough of the system, just to let you see a little bit about what's here and what's going on, give you a little feel for it, and then I'm going to play some music cuts for you and let you hear a little bit about what it's doing. Okay, guys, I'm only going to share all this stuff with you because you're going to ask me 100 times in the video if you see these speakers back here and I don't tell you anything about them. This is our Neo 3 tweeter. It's a planar magnetic design. That's a Neo 10 below it. It's in an open baffle configuration. We spent a considerable amount of time in development, testing the side wings, length of the side wings, testing the actual waveguide of the tweeter and the way that everything's mounted so that it creates a smooth response. The wings help separate the front wave from the back wave. It has to be asymmetrical the way it is. And that creates a smooth roll-off that I don't have to manipulate with a lot of crossover parts. As you can see, it doesn't have a high-order filter. The crossover parts are very high quality. Sonic caps, a MyFlex copper bypass cap. There's some ERCE XQ inductors. Uses tube connectors. Uses our high-quality internal wire. It plays down to about 180 hertz where it crosses to this little open baffle servo controlled system here. It has three of our 8-inch servo controlled woofers. It's a wedge shape open baffle design. It's got a single woofer on one side, two on the other. The servo controlled woofer in this case, the HX300, it has a filter in line with it that starts these things rolling off somewhere around 80 or 100 hertz. Gives them a nice gradual roll-off where they cross to this little monster. This is a triple stack of our 12-inch servo subs. It's using the Rhythmic A370 amplifier. And as you can see, there are a triple set of woofers on the back side here. Fully open, open on the front, open on the back. Giant H-frame design. This is covering from 50 hertz down to the teens, and servo control system is super fast. I'm not going to get into the entire system. I'll save that for another day. But let's just say for now, probably one of the top systems in the country.
high-level components throughout, super clean, super fast. It allows me to hear the things that I need to hear. Let's set some stuff up, and I'll run you through about three different samples, and we'll throw some text up there talking about the things that I'm listening for and looking for whenever I'm evaluating a pair of speakers.
Okay, one more thing before we go on to audio clips. If there's a piece of gear out there you're considering, electronics, speakers, whatever you're looking at, and you want to know how well these things were really designed, how much research and development really went into taking them to that next level, here's all you have to do. Ask the designer or manufacturer if you can see their listening room. Have a look at their listening room. What are they using for references? What does the room look like? That'll tell you everything you need to know. Now, let's go on playing some audio clips.
I told him that my dog wouldn't run. I told him that I love someone. Yeah, that's my old car out in the parking lot. I saw him when he first walked in. I thought it was a vision of him. He was looking like where he had been, looking kind of fragile. He said, I read the Bible every day, trying to keep the demons at bay. Thank God when the sun goes down, I don't blow it. My friend said, was he always like that? I said, yeah, but he was never this bad. I remember us playing for nickels and dimes out on the corner. I asked him to marry me once. He told me he couldn't because this would be all. Thank you.